Hi, this is Professor Jem A. Chan at California State University, Long Beach. In this video lesson today, we're going to look at graph of polynomial functions near a zero of multiplicity m. Let's define what we mean by multiplicity. For example, if the polynomial function f of x equals x plus 3 times x plus 2 and then times x minus 2, then each of those 3 is called a factor of the polynomial. And since each factor appears exactly once, we say that the zeros x equals negative 3, x equals negative 2, and x equals 2 each have multiplicity 1. If I now modify this a little bit and write f of x equals x plus 3 cubed, and then times x plus 2 squared, and then times x minus 2, then in this case, the factor x plus 3 appeared 3 times, so its 0, x equals negative 3, has multiplicity 3. The factor x plus 2 appeared 2 times, so its 0, x equals negative 2, is of multiplicity 2. And the factor x minus 2 only appeared 1 time, so its 0, x equals 2, is of multiplicity 1. A natural question to ask is whether or not a graph like such is going to look similar to the graph of the polynomial with multiplicity of all 1s. We notice that the dominating term from this polynomial would be x to the 6th, because the degree we get from the first factor is x cubed, the degree we get from the second factor is squared, and the degree we get from the third factor is 1. So if you actually add all those numbers up, 3 plus 2 plus 1 gives you a degree 6 polynomial. So it would be natural to think that the graph of this polynomial looks similar to the graph of x to the 6th, which looks very similar to the parabola that is flatter near the origin. So really the question is this really the case? It turns out that the polynomial of such shares the same similar shape as the polynomial x to the 6th in its n behaviors, but near the zeros, things do look a little differently. Let's investigate that next. Here I'll phrase my question formally. Let's look at what happens to the graph near a zero when the multiplicity is even or odd. We're going to denote the multiplicity by this letter m from this point on. Let's start with an even case. If m is even, then near that zero we must have one of those two following shapes. The first one is, for example, x plus 2 squared. Notice the even multiplicity there. In this case, if we do a test point analysis around the 0, negative 2, on the left-hand side, if we pick the test point of negative 2.1, we would get a positive sign because any number you stick in for x there and then square that at the end, you're always going to get a positive result. Similarly, if you use a right test point here, negative 1.9, stick it into this expression, you will also get a positive sign out of that. Which means that your function should look something like this near that 0, negative 2. On the other hand, the other case we can have is negative x plus 2 quantity squared. In this case, near the 0, negative 2, we should have a kind of opposite behavior because the effect that this negative sign causes. Anything you stick into this expression will always produce a positive quantity because we're squaring it. But sticking that negative sign in front just turns everything negative. So I would expect any test point I pick on the left of negative 2 to produce a negative number. Similarly, anything on the right of negative 2 would also produce a negative number. This tells you that the graph of this polynomial should look like this, near the negative 2. It shouldn't be too hard to imagine that if you change this number to any even number, the graph should always look like this. In summary, the graph does not cross the x-axis near the zero if the multiplicity is even, and it follows the same general shape as either y equals x squared or y equals negative x squared. And what we mean by does not cross the x-axis, it just means that it's either entirely sitting above the x-axis or below the x-axis. It doesn't do this kind of a crossing behavior like what x cubed would do. On the other hand, if m is odd, then near the zero we must have the following behaviors. Notice that we're actually going to look at the case where m is greater than 1. Because the case where m is equal to 1, that's just going to be a linear polynomial, which on its own looks very different from the polynomial of x cubed. For example, if m is odd, it could look like the shape of x cubed near the zero. For example, if negative 3 is the zero, which means x plus 3 is the factor, if having an odd power, for example, 3, then near that zero, negative 3, let's see what happens. Pick a test point to the right of negative 3, let's say negative 2.9, stick that into the x here, you would get an overall positive quantity, and then raised to the third power on that one would still be a positive quantity. If you pick a test point to the left of negative 3, let's say negative 3.1, put that into the factor here, you would get a negative quantity, and then raised to the third power would generate a negative quantity overall, which means that the graph of this polynomial near the 0, negative 3 should look like this. On the other hand, it could also look like negative x plus 3 cubed. If we pick a test point to the right of negative 3, negative 2.9, stick that in, I would get a positive quantity out of here. Cube that gives me a positive quantity still, but this negative sign here would turn this whole thing into a negative quantity overall. Pick a test point to the left of it, say negative 3.1, we get a negative quantity overall. Cube that negative quantity gives you a negative, but then stick in a negative sign in front will give you a positive quantity overall, which means that the graph of this polynomial near the roots negative 3 would look something like that, which is exactly the same shape of the graph of negative x cubed. In summary, in the graph crosses the x-axis if multiplicity is odd, and it follows the same general shape as y equals x cubed or y equals negative x cubed. And it shouldn't be so hard to see that if you change this power to anything that is odd, say 5, 7, 9, and on, the same type of behavior should still hold. In a special case when m is equal to 1, but that's just going to be some factor raised to the first power, the graph near that 0 looks exactly like a line, which means it still crosses the x-axis, except it's not going to be as smooth and curvy near the 0 as like in the case of x cubed. Next, let's use what we've just learned to graph this polynomial function that we've been using from the beginning. Just like the case when we're graphing using the zeros for the polynomials, the step one is to factor and to find out all zeros. But in this case, it's already in the factor form, so it's really simple in this step. I'm simply just write down all the zeros. The only thing different is that we have to write down zeros with their respective multiplicity. We kind of did that already in the beginning of the video here. So here we're going to proceed to step two, which is to use test points to figure out whether or not the graph lies entirely above or below the x-axis near those zeros. Along with that information, we're going to attach the multiplicity information on those zeros as well to remind us what the graph should look like near those zeros. My zeros are negative 3, negative 2, and 2. The multiplicity at negative 3 was 3, at negative 2 is 2, and at 2 the multiplicity is 1. I'm going to use a table to keep track of the signs of the function as well as the function value, which I will need anyways to graph at the end. I'm going to write down all the test points along with the zeros and the y-intercept in my table. One could potentially skip this entire column altogether if you're going to proceed and find the function value on those points anyways, because the function value would tell us whether or not the sign is positive or negative. Function value on negative 3.1 is 0.00617. Negative 3 is a 0, which means the function value should be 0 there. The function value on negative 2.5 there is negative 0.1406. Negative 2 is also a 0. The y-intercept when x is equal to 0 is at negative 216. 2 is also a 0. And at test point of 3, the function value is at 5400. This right away tells me that the sign at the first test point, negative 3.1, should be positive. The sign at the second test point, negative 2.5, should be negative. The sign at the test point 0 should be negative as well. And the sign at the test point 3 should be positive. It would be nice to put those sign information back on my x-axis. It's going to be positive here. I purposely put the positive above the x-axis to indicate it is going to sit above the x-axis. It's going to be negative over on this interval, negative on this interval, and a positive on this last interval. Step 3 is to confirm with the m behavior for this function. It is a degree 6 polynomial because you get a degree 3 from the first factor, you get a degree 2 from the second factor, and degree 1 from the third factors. Altogether, it's a degree 6 polynomial. This is an even degree with a positive leading coefficient, which means its end behavior should have exactly the same end behavior as x squared. And that is y goes to infinity as x goes to infinity, and y goes to positive infinity as x goes to negative infinity. Once we've confirmed the end behavior, we should be able to go back on our number line, or the x-axis, and draw those in. As x goes to positive infinity, we expect y goes to positive infinity. As x goes to negative infinity, y goes to positive infinity as well. So on this end, it should also look like that. Finally, we're going to incorporate the multiplicity information and the monomial information to complete the graph. On the first 0, we have multiplicity of 3, which means near that 0, negative 3, it should have the same graph as x cubed, or negative x cubed. It turns out that it looks similar to the negative x cubed because it's going from left to right, it's positive and negative, so it should look something like that. And remember, for the odd power, it has to cross through the x-axis. For the next 0 at negative 2, its multiplicity is 2. It's an even number, which means near x equals negative 2, it should look similar to either x squared or negative x squared. But because on the left and right of negative 2, both has negative power, which means that the graph should sit completely below the x-axis, and it should look something like that. On the very last 0 at x equals 2, it has a multiplicity of 1, which means near that 0, the graph should look like a line. Going from the negative to the positive, the graph should cross the x-axis, and it should look something like this. Now I think we're ready to sketch. But before you actually sketch, look at the function values a little bit. I noticed that it's quite different. I mean, you've got some really dramatically big function value. You got some really small function value as well. It's really hard to sketch all that in a single picture. So as we sketch, we're just going to use some hypothetical number on there, not to be precise. Here I'm going to label my zeros first, and also notice the end behavior. It should look like this on this left end, and it should look like that on the right end as well. When the x value is at negative 2.5, you get this negative 0.1406, which is somewhere in the middle here, quite small. The y-intercept is going to be at about 216 negative. And that's going to be way down there somewhere. Like I said, we don't really quite care exactly where that happens. We just want to get a general picture and shape. So with those information in mind, we can graph. I'm going to try to do this freehand in one pass and see how that goes. Okay, so on the left, it's going to go up like this. I'm going to crest through negative 3, and it's going to dip below a little bit, and then come back up to negative 2. And remember, at negative 2, you have a multiplicity of even, which means it doesn't cross the x-axis. It should still sit below, and it's going to just turn back down. Eventually, we're going to come back and intersect the y-axis as somewhere at 216 negative, and then come back up to hit 2 at function value of 0, and then just going to keep going and then just grow really big once it passes 2. Remember, because at the test point of 3, we do have that function value of 5400, which is really big. And so this is the general picture of a shape of this polynomial we have investigated.